Srinivasan, who is the founder director of Pro Ventures. I welcome you all to the session and hope this is going to be a good learning experience for you. So with this, I'll hand over the session to Srinivasan sir to introduce today's topic and also about the speaker. Over to you, Srinivasan sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Ratna. So I think most of you know me, so I don't need any introduction. I just come just to begin the session and I'll stay with you as a participant through the session. So my name is P. Srinivasan. I'm heading Pro Ventures Design and Deliver Programs. Let me first give a couple of minutes of introduction about the topic. This is a kind of a unique series we are starting. Today is the, we can say, an inaugural session. What we want to do is, PMI has acknowledged the art of project management as a separate domain with the title called People Aspect of Project Management. And then they have defined 14 tasks as the key, the target areas of learning and internalization and practice for every project manager, project management professional. And then they made it as a kind of a mandate to teach all the aspiring project managers about it. So this we have already incorporated in the 35 contact hours, but also we thought we will run this as a separate leadership series, which actually reinforces these core concepts from an application perspective and also strengthen their understanding and get ready with more confidence for the examination. So with that in focus, actually we gave this the content outline tasks to Mr. B. Krishnamurthy, and then
sorry to interrupt, your voice is little low and it's kind of cracking.
Okay
slightly low, maybe if you can increase any settings.
Second, actually just give me a moment, just give me 30 seconds, I'll just add maybe the headset that I am using.
Is it better now? Hello,
yes,
Rasna?
Yes, it's good, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm sorry for the other interruption. So, Mr. B. Krishnamurthy is my colleague as part of the faculty panel of Pro Ventures. And you can say he's one of the earliest adapter of information technology leadership way back in 1980s, and he established Wipro Center in Hyderabad when it was established, one of the earliest IT company in Hyderabad to set up their office. And then he went on to academics to head Center for Organization Development as a director. And he is closely associated with Government of India in terms of NISG, National Institute for Smart Governance, in terms of giving the policy direction, training in many areas of e-governance and other stuff. And I can keep speaking more and more about his laurels. And also, he kept in pace with emerging developments in catching up with the other credentials in terms of PMP, portfolio management, and change management, executive coaching. So these are the different areas he specialized. But most important thing I like about Mr. BKM is his humility for that kind of his excellence. He's a very, very down-to-earth person, and he's more of a people person than a process person, I would say. So that's why he handles change management and other things so effectively. So we thought he would be the right person, okay, to take this people development skill to the next level of maturity among our audience. So we wanted to make it adaptable for both aspiring PMPs as well as certified PMPs and other practicing professionals in the areas of leadership, project program, and portfolio management. So that is our vision. So this will be a series of topics, at least for the next 3 to 4 months. Okay, so you can expect a continued communication from us, every fortnight, and we will take it in a logical sequence as prescribed by PMI, as well as that aligns with the industry practice. So you can expect more than the exam content outline in terms of sharing his experience and other illustrated examples, and also he will make it more interactive. So please participate, and not just on this one, you can continue to attend these sessions, subscribe to our communication, and then receive it. So with these few words, I would like to pass it on to BKM sir, and sit back, relax, and then enjoy the session and participate and be benefited. Thank you. Thank you for coming, and over to Sir BKM.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Srinivasan. You have been very liberal and kind in going through the introduction and our association, which is more than almost 1.5 decades now. Thanks, Ratnakumari, for bringing up this introduction and setting up the whole process. So I think I have the right to sharing rights has come in now. So I'll start sharing my screen. Good evening to you all, my dear friends. I am happy to be here. When we started talking about this particular activity as a part of our, continued conversations between the two of us, when this opportunity came and we thought, why not we do this for the benefit of everybody, not only from the point of view of exam, but also from the point of view of practice. So we said, let us put this together and address it in a series of sessions. And that is how the whole thing has come in now. I'm hoping that I'm audible and you are able to see the slides.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what we will do is we have divided this people component, which is 42% of the PMP exam. There are 14 task areas. We have divided them into logical sequencing, and today we are going to cover 2 tasks. And the tasks are not in the order of task number 1, 2, 3, 4. They are starting from 6 and 7, and maybe 3 and 5. The sequencing is from the point of view of the way we do things. Okay. The other point I wanted to share here is I have been a practitioner all along, and putting theory after the practice. I am not a typical professor. So many a times when I say something, it is out of my own experience. And each one can have a different experience. So please feel free to ask me questions. And if I don't know, I don't have a problem in saying, I don't know. I will get back to you through a mail or in the subsequent session. So we will keep it interactive, and I wish all the best to all of us to go through the sessions. So first topic will be on building a team. So this covers appraise the stakeholder skills, project resource requirements, what is required from the point of view of the project, and continuously assessing it and refreshing the teams, because it is not a one-time activity, it is a continuous activity. And then we have to also maintain the team from the point of view of their spirit as well as the transfer of knowledge as the teams go through various phases of its development. There are various enablers for this. The enablers are listed out here as part of the exam ECO part. Okay, the section numbers are mentioned here. You can refer to them in the booklet. We will cover them as practical aspects now. But again, we will be using tools like RACI matrix, tools, virtual teams, dealing with virtual teams, skill sets, technologies, resource assignments, etc. All these things will be dealt as part of the session. Now, what does it take to build a team? What all does it involve? So when I started thinking about it, I thought it's easier to put some numbers or put some abbreviations. So you will keep hearing this from me from session to session, either some numbers or some abbreviations, because that is the easiest way to remember them and also to internalize them. That is how kind of I used to remember things. So I call it as Simply Five. The Simply Five contains two fives, one five, the do's, and the other five, the don'ts. Let us look at the do's. The first five do's are choice of people, suitability versus familiarity. See, there's a tendency in all of us that we want to choose a familiar person, a friend, rather than a person who is suitable for the task, suitable for the role. Many a times we fill the boxes with the names of people rather than what is expected of that particular role. So we should be careful in choosing the right person rather than the known person. Second part is matching the role need versus person available. This also is a major, habit for us. We would like to put people whom we know in the job which we think is easier for them to do, or we fill them there because they are there. They may not be experts in that. They may not be people who are well versed in doing that area. But still we fill that person there. So in a way, point number one and two are connected, but number two is more important than number one, because sometimes we put a very introvert person in a sales job, in a job which involves talking to people, then that person will fail miserably. On the other hand, we put an extrovert person, a person who goes around, talks a lot, wants to meet people. We put that person in a job which is desk job, where he is supposed to do collection of metrics, reporting of metrics, etc. in the form of a MIS report. We are actually using him for a wrong reason. So we need to match the role versus the person's availability and their skills. Then selecting with the right experience. If you are working in a company and you are given people, I am saying given people, you don't have a choice. I've been in Wipro for a long time. We used to have the people allocation team, which gives teams for every project. So we call it as an onion mix. This onion mix, the shape of an onion, right? It's like a kind of a bulge in the middle, and then conical at the top and the bottom, sharp at the top and the bottom. That is how most of the teams are formed. What do I mean by this? You have a senior person there at the top, one or two people, and you have very junior people, one or two at the bottom, and you have a lot of people in the middle, experienced, who cover the entire project, which means we are increasing the cost of the project by putting people with medium experience. The job requires only 4 years to 5 years experience, but we have filled that with a person with 9 years experience. The cost of the 9 year person is very high compared to that of a 5 year experienced person. So this bulge mix, we call it as a bulge mix. That bulge mix has to be appropriate, because each project has a cost. That cost element has to be appropriately utilized. Otherwise, we will end up in making a project loss. So we need to have the right mix of people. then we have got all these things. But many a times, in the interest of collecting people for our projects, sometimes we as project managers go out of the way to promise something. Yes, you finish this project, I'll get a promotion for you. You finish this project, I will send you on site. Or I will give you that other important project. Things like that. You know, unless otherwise we have complete control on all of this, we should not give false promises or create false expectations. This will create trouble not only in the project, but also in us, we as leaders. What will it do? It will create credibility issue, credibility crisis. They will think that, yeah, this fellow, yeah, you know, he will promise the moon, but when you go there, you won't even have a promotion or you won't even get a hike. People will talk behind our back. And then defining the roles and outcomes very clearly. Whoever we identified for whatever job we identified, we should give them the clear roles, expectations, and tell them what we want from them. The outcomes which are required, we have to define them very clearly. So these are the basic five do's. I can keep writing down a lot of things, but these are all the basic things which I feel are very critical when we start building a team. At the same time, when we build the team, we should not do certain things. Why am I saying this? Because all our life, we have been taught stories, whether it is Panchatantra or whether it is scriptures. We have all the stories are told in the positive tone as well as in the negative tone. So it is basically to reinforce the whole thing again and again. So that is exactly what I am following here. Don't prioritize people over the outcome. This actually goes in line with this suitability versus familiarity. We should bother about the project rather than the people. We should not allow conflicts to linger and impact this both working. We will talk about conflict management at a later session, but I just want to tell you here that as a leader, project manager, conflicts are good. Conflicts create innovation. Conflicts create better solutions. But again, conflicts cannot be lingering on. Conflicts have to be managed. I am using the word managed intentionally. Not all conflicts can be resolved. So what we need to do is, if there is a conflict, get hold of the people, talk to them, find an amicable solution or find a solution which suits the project, and then give a decision either this way or that way, or find a new way of doing it, and then finish that issue then and there. If the conflict persists, then it will be a problem. Imagine a situation, we are talking about a project where the architecture has to be finalized or a design has to be finalized. There are two different views of the design. And then we don't bring the people together for finalizing the design. Both people are working on their own design with their own agenda, with their own timelines. Then the clock is ticking. And by the time we realize it will be 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and each one will claim that I have gone far ahead into the design, so don't change it now. So it will be a problem for the project outcome. So we need to be very clear. If the conflicts are there, we should not allow it to persist for a long time. We should not be biased on certain people. See, all of us are human beings. We have some better feeling with some people, not so much good feeling with some other people. We are feeling at home with some people and we are not feeling at home with some other people. But that should not come in the way of our working. Personal life and personal liking is different from professional liking. So we should be not only be honest, we should also be seen as being honest, not being biased or not being positive to certain people. The so-called insiders, we should not create insiders in the project with the project manager. And we should not reward the wrong person. This is very important. There are situations where I have come across a project manager says, I have 8 people in my team. I have to go, HR has given me a budget of reward, so much money. So what I decided is that I'll give 1% every month. So it is on a rotation basis. Recognition is not by rotation basis. Reward, if the same person gets 4 months, let it be so. but it should be the person who has done the best and who everybody acknowledges that he has done the best. It is very important that we do that as part of our activities. And the last one is blocking communication selectively. The word selectively is very important here, because we know communication plays a major role. I mean, communication itself deserves a long series of lectures. But in a project communication, it is very important that the relevant communications reach the relevant people. I'm using the words carefully. What, who needs to know what has to be decided, and it has to be communicated to them in time, accurately and appropriately. If it has to be told, you have to tell them. If it has to be sent by a mail, it has to be sent by mail. If it has to be circulated like a notice, it has to be circulated like a notice. So we cannot be selectively blocking or enabling communications, which actually creates distrust, mistrust in the complete set of people around us, which is not a good practice for the project, which is not a good or healthy thing for the project to run. So these are the building team simply five, which I have put as a formula, the do's and don'ts. Together will form a basic ground for us to form the team. We have formed the team. So what do we do with the team next? So we have to tell them what are they supposed to do, how their work gets aligned with the organization's objectives, how whatever they are doing is going to contribute to the organization's overall vision and mission, and how should they behave, how do we measure their success, what should be their behavior, what should be the way in which they can show themselves as progressive. Okay, all that is conveyed here through this chart. So let us take the organization. The organization has a vision where the organization wants to be. That is the vision. In 3 years from now, we'll be among the top three in the industry. We have to be among the top three in the industry in the next 5 years. That is the vision. Mission is what we want to be. You will be having milestones. You have to keep on achieving those milestones to reach there. There are variations technically on vision, mission, values, but we are not getting into that. Right now, our understanding is to align the project to the requirement of the organization. That's what we are trying to do. So how are we going to do this? That is the strategy part. How? By executing projects in this area, by executing projects from this geography. That is the strategy. These will evolve into two sets of things. What we do and how we do it. This what we do, they are all hard things, tangible stuff. How we do it is the intangible stuff. This can be seen, but measuring is difficult. This can be felt, but measuring is difficult. But these all have to be measured. They are all measurable objectives. Measurable KPIs will be there. There will be a target, there will be a stretch target, there will be a lot of initiatives which are taken. All this is part of the performance management. So we have the vision, mission that is driven down by the strategy. From the strategy, we arrive at a set of actions, measurable actions, what we do. That is part of forming the objectives, measures, targets, etc. Then how are we doing it? How are we achieving what we are achieving? Are we following some ethics? Are we following some integrity in our behavior? Are we inclusive in our approach? Are we tolerant towards the other gender? How are we dealing with people with disability? How are we talking to customers? How are we talking to people who are lower in our organization? All that are part of this. So they are driven by the values of the organization. There are standards which are followed, operational standards. The rules and the standard operating procedures, they are all part of this. And then the behaviors. How do we demonstrate that we care for people? How do we demonstrate that customer is the king? How do we demonstrate that we treat all genders equally? Okay, all that is part of the value system. And then in order to make sure that we measure all these things, we get feedback that is called as a 360 degree feedback. In the 360 degree feedback, let us say you are the project leader, your boss, your peers, and your team members. Everybody will evaluate this project leader on the behavior front, on all these fronts. And that will be collated, and then that will be measured. So that is the measure of the values, how we do it. So this is very, very important. In the case of any project, we need to align the vision, mission to the project goals. Okay, I will quickly tell a story here. There was a man who was walking. He's a pedestrian. He was walking on the road. He went to a village and he saw a lot of people doing sculpture, you know, statues. They were making statues, cutting the stones and making the statues. So there was a fellow, he stopped there and asked him, "What are you doing?" He actually wiped the sweat on the forehead and then said, "Don't you see what I am doing? I'm cutting the stone. Don't waste my time, carry on." So this pedestrian started walking forward. Then he found another fellow doing the same thing, cutting the stone and making some statues. He asked that fellow, he said, "Yes, I am making a statue. So don't waste my time, carry on." The first fellow said, "I am cutting the stone." The second fellow said, "I am making a statue." He was wondering, what is this going on? All of them are doing similar work, but why is this fellow saying like this? He was puzzled, but he didn't still get the answer. He was not satisfied with the answer. Though he got the answer, he was not satisfied with the answer. So he moved further. Little distance away, there was another man who was standing there. He went and asked the same question, "What are you doing?" That fellow said, he put the, you know, a hammer and a chisel down and then said, "Who are you? Are you a new person to this place?" He said, "Yes." "Yeah, you don't know that this king of this place has, you know, won the battle and he is trying to build a monument here. And then this victory monument is going to be like a temple. It will have some so many pillars and so many statues, and this statue is going to be situated here. And all of us have been brought from various places to do this. And this is going to be done by such and such time." He was talking about all the details of the whole project. Now, what are we trying to do here? We are trying to do here alignment of the vision with respect to what they are doing. All the three of them are cutting the stone and making statues. The first fellow said, "I am earning a living." Second fellow said, I am making a statue." Third fellow said, "I am contributing to the monument." Okay, we need to create people. And I'll give you our live example. I've seen a lot of people when I meet some people in social gathering, or even in Wipro when I was there, when I meet somebody in the cafeteria, I ask them, "What are you doing?" "I am doing Java coding. I am working in .NET. I mean, working in .NET is a vehicle for doing something else, but what are you doing? That, so we need to have that alignment to the big picture. Unless otherwise we align ourselves to the big picture, it is going to be extremely difficult for us to have their heart and soul into the work. We will have their legs and hands and legs, but we need heart and soul into getting into the project. The other example I can think of is CDOT, where I started working in 85 to 97, I worked there. Sam Pitroda, you must have heard the name. It got spoiled later because of his involvement with some political parties, but he was the one who created the vision for us. 36 months, 36 crores and India self-reliant telecommunication. Today's telecommunication goes back to those kind of buzzwords which he created. And all of us as young engineers worked under his guidance. And then we are making a national level telecom revolution. Everybody would talk of a national revolution of telecom in India. Okay, which actually happened over a period of time. So we need to align ourselves to a larger cause, whether we are working on a small project or a big project. That process happens through making them. How do you make this happen? Once you form the team, we have something called as a project kickoff meeting. In the project kickoff, I'm sure it will have different names in different organizations, but this happens with varied levels of details. People say that I don't have time to do this meeting, so I'm starting the project right away. If you ask me, whenever we have had these meetings, we have had better success and faster results. If you ask me, did you do it for all the projects? No, we didn't do it for all the projects. But we did this for more than 70-75% of the projects. But wherever we have done this in a detailed manner, we have been meeting with success. So where we align their project goal to the larger goal of the company. So this plays a major role. I'll just cover some more topics and then I'll stop there for a question, answer and interaction with you. Kindly bear with me because this logical sequence will continue this way. Then when we come to goal setting, we need to define the purpose of the job and duties for them. And then we have to give them the performance goals. I'm sure all of you know this, but I'm stressing on certain specific points that these will become the questions in the exam, the nitty-gritties. Mota mota, a lot of people know. At a larger level, we all of us know it. But again, the minute things and the finer points are the ones where we miss out. Since measurable outcome has to be defined, the measurable outcome. This is very debatable. A lot of people say, how can I measure the job of a secretary? Give me a job, I will be able to give you the measurements. A secretary, how do you define a secretary? Secretarial person, who is an assistant, executive assistant. Do you measure the person by the number of pages she types? Or how many times you review it? How many mistakes she makes it? How do you review it? So we need to define that based on the outcome. Effectiveness, not efficiency, has to be defined. Then define priority for the jobs. We may give some 4 or 5 tasks to somebody. They do not know which order to take, which task to take first and which one to take later. And if you are the project manager, we should tell them, these are all the top priority activities. You finish this and then go to the next one. If you don't do it, what happens? It's a human tendency that we will take the easiest job first. And then the most important job and the difficult one will remain towards the end, which is actually going to be delay for us. Then we also define the performance standards. For example, if I'm asking somebody to give me a report, I have to tell him that I need a report by Friday evening, 4 o'clock. And I want the report to be in the form of an Excel. I want that Excel data to be available in the form of a pie chart. And these charts have to be in PPT, not more than 4 slides. Parameters 1, 2, 3, 4, that's it. And I want this by Friday 4 p.m. That is performance standards. Defining what you need. We have to tell them what we want. We don't want to tell them how to do it. Let them decide how to do it. This is another lesson for managing a team. We tell them how to do it based on our experience. Today's people, the teams, they know much better ways of doing things, much faster ways of doing things. So it is important to tell what we want rather than how to do it. This is again very, very important lesson. I have picked up this because initially I was telling them how to do it, but somebody came and told me that will take extra time than the way I think. This is the way I think I can do. Are you okay with it? I said, okay, go ahead and do it. So that is when it was something like a revelation for me. Till then, I was also telling what to do and how to do. After this particular incident, it happened twice with this person, the same person. I realized I was doing this, which is not required, which is not relevant. But I also tell them, if you don't know how to do it, come back to me. It's not that leaving them and then letting them off the hook completely. We need to tell them, you go ahead and this is what I want. At this time I want, this is the quality. Let them figure out and come back. And we can also tell them one sentence, in case you are stuck somewhere, come back to me for help. That has helped a lot, that has worked a lot. Then we talk about SMART goals. I am sure all of you know this, but I am putting this here for the sake of completion. It has to be a specific goal. State what exactly you want to accomplish, okay? Then it has to be measurable. It has to be demonstrable and it has to be subject to measurable. It has to be, you can scale it down, you can scale it up, you can figure out whether it is in terms of hours or in terms of work products, whatever way it is, we have to define that. Then it has to be achievable. If a person who is doing a long jump of, let us say 12 feet, we give him 18 feet, he can't do it. We give him 12.5, he will cross 12.5, then give 13, then give 13.5. Over a period of time, that is what is called as a stretch goal. For a person who is getting 60% mark in exams, we tell him to score 90%. It is not possible. we can tell them next time you take a target of 65. Maybe you will touch 64, still better. So it has to be an achievable goal. But on the other hand, it has to be stretchable also. It has to be giving a challenge to the person. And then whatever goal we are giving has to be relevant. It has to be relevant to the vision and mission. It has to be relevant to the project. It has to be relevant to the organizational context. It cannot be an irrelevant measure. It has to be relevant to the context. And then it has to be time bound. It has to be time bound in terms of duration or in terms of a date on a milestone. On this particular day, you are supposed to complete this. Something like that has to be given. I'm sure all of you know this, but I'm sharing this here only for the sake of completion. So we have done the team. What have we done so far? We have found the team members. We have brought them together. We have decided what to do with the team. We have given them the project. We have given them the measurables. We have given them the mission, vision, all of that. Now we need to plan for the resources for these people. The word here, we are using the resources. It is both people resources as well as the other resources. The other resources are the computer, licenses, the whole lot of things connected with that. So after we identify these people, we need to also look at the training strategies. Not all of them may be well-versed in the training in the area what we want to work. All of them may not have the required skills. So we need to identify the training needs. Somebody may require training on coding. Somebody may require training on inspection. Somebody else may require training on communication. So we need to decide which one we have to send them for training and which one we'll keep it on the job training. How do we make them to learn these things? We have talked about roles and responsibilities, authority. We need to talk about the authority of the individual. What is it that they can decide? What is it that they have to come to you or go up above you for approvals? Okay, that authority has to be very clearly defined. And then guidance on the life cycle of the team resources, how they are defined, staffed, managed, and eventually released. So how the team builds up, peak, and then it tapers down. When the delivery happens, the team tapers down and there is a maintenance acceptance phase and then maintenance phase, and then the team eventually gets dissolved. Then we are also talking about putting the organization chart and then their reporting relationship. This is extremely important. We should never bypass the reporting relationship. When I say we should never bypass the reporting relationship, what I mean is, you can talk to them, you can find out what they are doing, but you should never give them instructions or take inputs from them directly, unless otherwise it is of a different nature. Okay. So we should allow the organization structure to deal with normal routine work. If you bypass them, we are in for trouble. We are in for surprises, because the people down below can misuse this opportunity to play between, let's say, myself and my second level, immediate second level, and then create trouble in the project execution. Then resource controls for the management of physical resources to support the team. Physical resources could be the machines, equipments, whole lot of things. There are certain projects where you will have to share the machine, share the lab equipment. So we need to find out what rule will be applied, who will need what, how do you schedule the usage of that equipment or instrument. We need to work out these things. Even if you are talking about a software project, if it is a mechanical design or CAD CAM tools, they are extremely costly. We don't buy 10, there are 10 members, we don't buy 10 licenses. We buy probably 3 licenses. So who will use what at what time? This has to be worked out. Okay, and the recognition plan, how they will be rewarded and recognized. What will be the measure of recognition? Okay, we used to have in one of my projects, we used to have something called as a gladiator of the month. Somebody who did manage client situation, a difficult client situation, and turned around, dealt with him in a much better way. So that is called Gladiator of the Month. And for this, the project manager has defined a nice way. He said, team members have to nominate the Gladiator of the Month. All the members, there were 18 team members in that particular project. He will get 18 nominations. The one who got the maximum nomination will get it. And he will ensure that that is actually validated by the activities through the weekly reports and weekly meetings, etc. This used to happen every month. So we make them to be responsible for it. We define the process. We make them to be responsible for it and make it transparent. The most important part is the transparency. I was mentioning in the beginning that if there are 8 people in a team, it cannot be given on a rotation. In January, Mr. A, February, Mr. B. So in the month of November, again, B gets it. It is not that way. It is not on a rotation basis. The moment we do it on rotation basis, then the validity of the recognition, the value of the recognition will go away. I know anyway, I will get it next month. That is not the way it should be. It is okay. The same person gets 5 times in a row. That is perfectly fine. Then the next part is putting a responsibility allocation matrix, which is called RACI chart. I'm sure all of you are aware of it, but for the sake of completion, again, I would like to state this here. This is one way of putting people in the right place for their right roles and for the tasks which are mentioned. Okay. For every task, we tell there is an accountable person whose head will be chopped if the work doesn't happen. That person is accountable. You can have multiple responsibilities, you can have multiple consultancies, you can have multiple information, but only one person accountable. The moment we have 2 persons accountable, then the job is half done. Why? Because there is a famous saying, right? Everybody's job becomes nobody's job. Because everybody will think the other person will do it. So there has to be one person accountable for the task. So for every task identified, we put a person accountable, and there are other people who needed to be consulted or who is responsible. The responsible person can provide assistance. Person can collect data, provide assistance, provide support. All of that can be there. But accountability, who is accountable, whose head will be chopped if the work doesn't happen? That is this accountable person. What does it do? It actually defines who does what. This is a beautiful way of avoiding duplication of work. You can't have 2 people working on the same task. Otherwise, I will take up the easiest task. The same way somebody else will also feel, and he will also take the same thing. That's a wasted effort in a way. And then to get a shared understanding of people and their roles. So the moment we make a RACI chart, you don't have to make it and paste it in every project if it is a small project. Okay. But if it is a large project, if it is a very critical project, this makes a lot of sense. Unless otherwise, by and large, people have a good understanding and it is a well-known team, well-functioning team. This is kind of understood. But still, I still say that it is good to have the clear definition of who will do what, which is very, very critical. This is an important slide. It's a very favorite slide of mine. We have formed the team. We have defined the rules. Now we have to start playing the game of executing the project. Now the actual live thing starts. In this here, we are talking about skills, accountability, and commitment of the people. And then we are also talking about the collective work product, which creates a performance result. It also results in personal growth for the individuals. Okay. Now, if you look at the skills, we are talking about technical and functional skills. A person is supposed to be doing some technical work or a functional work. Technical work can be coding, designing, constructing. Okay. Functional work can be quality verification, or if it's a large project, there will be a HR function. You may have different shifts. People have to come in and go out. All of that is part of this. And then the other skills which are very relevant are problem solving and interpersonal. Interpersonal is probably the most important one when you are dealing with a project of complexity, even otherwise. How do you relate to the other person? How well we are able to work as a team? How do you give and how do you take things? Interpersonal. And this also plays a role in problem solving. Problems will be there in every project. Take it from me, there is no project without a problem. That is the case. I mean, it is not a project. So problem solving has to happen, for which we need to have open mind, collective efforts, and good interpersonal communication and relationship. So the skills part takes care of all of this. Then comes accountability. When interpersonal relationships are good and problem solving attitude is there, there will be mutual accountability. I have a problem. You are an expert in that. You know I am struggling on this particular issue. So you come forward from yourself and say, BKM, I know how to solve this. Give me 15 minutes, I'll sit with you and sort it out. You are coming by yourself to give helping hand to me. So you are giving a mutual accountability. Next time I will feel that I should help you out in some way or the other, okay? Individually also, each one of us have our own accountability. Smaller teams also have their own accountability. So from the skills, we bring in accountability and we bring in delivery focus as the major point for the project. Why are we doing all this? We are doing all this to give the goals, achievement of the goals. That is a common approach. And why are we doing this? To achieve the meaningful purpose of the organizational goal. Okay. So it starts from the skills and then we become mutually accountable and we try to achieve the goal. What if my goal is different from the organizational goal? Okay. It is possible. So we will have circles like this. You know, our individual mindset, individual goal is different from common vision, common goal. How much of overlap can exist between these two? We try to increase the overlap, the better the result. Then as and when we deal with the project, we try to involve other people, create accountability, share them, interpersonal relationship. So this circle also becomes overlapping with these two in a much closer way. Then you create a nice congenial environment for the project. So that is how we need to create cohesive teams, cohesive project teams create fantastic results. And it is visible from the way they function and the way they do their tasks. I just want to add something more here because I came across this, I felt it was good. So I put this here. It starts with a common goal, okay? Because we have a common goal, there is cohesion. Cohesion is nothing but synergy. All of us are oriented towards the same direction. It is something like the boat race, what you see in Kerala. I'm sure you must have seen that boat race in Kerala. Long boat of something like 20 feet. There'll be something like 25, 30 people sitting on either side, and they will all be rowing in the same direction and they will all go together. That synergy will be there. When we do the synergy, then there is a collaboration. People, I know this, you bring that, then together we achieve more. So that is the collaboration happens. All this happens through commitment and communication. Commitment to the goal, which we have started with, and communication on the progress, communication on the issues, resolving problems, again back communication, etc. So it keeps going in a sequential fashion. And then comes continuous improvement. Whatever I have done last time is not okay. Let me do it better. Let me do it better next time. So there is a continuous improvement. That leads to creativity of finding out problems, finding out solutions, finding out easier ways of doing things. So that way, it's like a cycle. It keeps continuing. It is not a circle. It is a spiral. It goes up. So every circle, once you finish, you go to the next higher orbit. From there, you go to the next higher orbit. So as we do projects in a systematic way, at the end of each project, we become more knowledgeable. We become more equipped. We become more mature. That is the cycle. So it is like a spiral going upwards. So ultimately, we, along with the rest of the team, have to keep moving upward and moving forward. Then a couple of other points about the team. This is the last slide in this capsule. what we do when we form the teams, we talked about a lot of other things, okay? But in the current scenario, we need to remember the team formation is a dynamic exercise. If the project is for 6 months, you have the team for 6 months. If the project is for 1.5 years, you have the team for 1.5 years. Within that 1.5 years, there will be some movement of people. So it is dynamic. It is also dynamic to indicate that they are high energy teams. The people have to have high energy. You can't be coming to the work with, you know, shaggy face and then say, oh yeah, I have to come to work. That doesn't work. That kind of project team will not succeed. It has to be result oriented. It has to adjust itself as situation evolves. This is the most important part. Think of this pandemic. Exactly a year ago, we were not thinking of working from home. We were thinking of going to work, meeting people physically, and then traveling all around the world, etc., etc. Come April, come March 24th, there was a lockdown in India, and the rest of the world went into lockdown. People started working from home, virtual meetings, a whole lot of things. And still, projects were delivered. Things were happening. So teams have to adjust itself and evolve themselves to the new situations. This is on the working and the functioning of the team. Then on the composition of the team, it has to be a diverse team. Diverse meaning it should have both men and women. There are some people who are very comfortable with only man team or the other way around. Okay, but I have seen teams are successful when you have something like 35 to 40% of the team is females. Okay, women contribute much different level of thinking in problem solving. That is my personal experience. So there has to be a gender mix. Demography. If you have people, all of them from Andhra Pradesh, they will end up talking in Telugu. I don't have a problem in somebody talking in Telugu. But again, we forget the other side, the client side, who is sitting the other end of the globe, not able to understand what we are talking. So demography has to be mixed. The idea of demography mix is that we have something called as groupthink. People coming from certain area or certain demography have certain way of thinking. So everybody starts thinking in the same way. We don't have a variety of thinking. We don't have a different view. So you tell me something, I agree with you, and then somebody else agrees with you, then we think that that is the world. Actually, there is a bigger world outside. We don't understand things beyond what we know under our nose. Then comes able people versus persons with disability. PWD stands for persons with disability. This brings a beautiful dimension. Normally, they say that people who have some disabilities have some extra skills. This is true. I have seen it happen. They are able to think better. They are able to come up with better solutions, better options for problems. So if you have in a group one or two people who are physically disabled, they can contribute in a totally different manner than what we think. And to a large extent, it has to be cross-cultural across the different cultures. Now we are talking about a global team, virtual team. Then we can have somebody from Italy, somebody from US, somebody from Israel. So cross-cultural, different age group. This is important, but we have to be careful. Different age group can be 20s and 30s and 40s, but 20s and 70s or 20s and 60s can create a problem. So we need to have broad base. You remember that onion mix, onion bulge I talked about. So we need to remember with respect to the age group also in a similar way. Different backgrounds. If people are coming from the same campus, recruited from same campus, you put them all in the same team, then we'll have a problem. One, they'll be doing a lot of bunking and going to the movies and then fooling around. Number two, they will all think in the same way. So we need to look at people with different backgrounds. Geographical spread, people from Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, then somebody from UP, somebody from Manipur. So we need to have a broad this one. Then cross-functional, people working in technical, people working in quality, working in HR, or in case you have engineers coming from civil background, chemical background, electronics background. So again, cross-functional, cross-domain experience. All this adds to the flavor, all these adds to the color of the team. when the color of the team is like a kaleidoscope, like a spectrum, we have a better result because of the diverse thinking, because of the background they come from. With that, I complete the first block, first capsule of what we wanted to speak. I will stop here for a few minutes till we answer our questions, and then we will have a small quiz for you to understand what you have learned has made sense for you, and then we'll go to the second module. I'll stop here and wait for you to ask me questions, please. And if there are any questions in the chat, maybe I'll request Ratna to help me out.
Yeah, I will be here, sir.
If anything, please help me out with the question in the chat box.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, most of you have already learned, studied about it, had in your earlier training also. So I'm sure you might be having some questions or something to expand. Feel free to ask. We can discuss any questions that you like to get it clarified. Or if you would like to share some experience also, no problem. You can do so.
That's correct. That's correct. I missed saying that, Srinivasan. Thank you for saying that. Yes. Any views, comments, questions, all are welcome. This is a joint learning. Okay. I am only sharing some thoughts from my side.
So it looks like people are thinking. So you can go for the quiz, sir. Because they have to, they are forced to speak.
Yes, I agree with you. I agree with you.
I think you need to escape the show mode for to play that game.
Okay.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, now you can point to that slide.
I can go to the next slide, right?
Yeah.
Shall I go to the full screen mode now, or is it okay?
No, you can't. I have not done that. Just leave it as it is. I think we are able to read. Or you can just slightly expand the slider at the bottom. Yeah. So that, yes. Yeah. So now you can ask the question, let them answer, and then you can drag and drop it back in the blue background. So
where we want to be, what does it do? Which one of these is correct?
Vision.
Vision, yeah.
Where we want to be is vision. People agree?
Yes.
What we want to be?
Objective.
Mission.
Okay, is it objectives or mission?
Mission.
Mission. Any other thoughts from anybody else? Anybody disagrees with that? So, what we want to be is mission. How we will get there?
Strategy.
Strategy.
Very good. So, all of you are there. Very good. So, what we do is?
Objective.
Objectives. So the last answer is anyway. Most difficult one, I suppose.
We should have put one more so that.
Okay. Let me answer this question, okay?
So this is actually a new way introduced with the PMP examination. So there will be a kind of interactive mode, drag and drop, these kind of things. So I thought, let me put on of this size on this space. Yes, sir. Yeah, yes, sir.
Please clap for yourself, you know, all of you. Whoever answered, please clap. Whoever did not answer, also you can clap because you thought, but you didn't share it here, maybe.
Okay.
Somebody raised a point, something? Come on, you I don't understand how there cannot be any questions or any statements. You can dispute what I said. I'm okay with that.
Can you please little bit explain why the mission and objective that means the answer varies? I thought it's objective and it came to be mission. For the second question, what we want to be?
Objectives, what we want to do is on a day-to-day basis, on a quarterly basis, weekly basis, monthly basis, okay? What we do is objectives. Every week we want to finish off certain things. Every week we want to progress. It's something like a meter. You want to keep moving the meter towards the final goal. That is the objectives. Okay, what we want to be is mission, or what you want to achieve. Okay, and these are all milestones to reach the vision. Milestones to reach the vision is your mission. There are multiple milestones. These milestones can be done annually or 18 months once or something like that. Whereas vision is your 5-year term or 3-year term. Today, 5-year term doesn't mean anything because a lot of things are changing every 2 to 3 years. So it is good to have a vision which is about 3 years. So that is why our horizon is about 3 years for most of the industries today. Even manufacturing industry is going for a 3-year, max 4 years nowadays. Earlier it used to be 5-year and 10-year vision, but today it doesn't make sense. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, yes. No, okay. I understand.
Good. Yeah. Any other point, please? Was there anything new in what I said? Anything different than what you know already?
Yes, this terms like we are keeping a mission as a milestone, it give a clarity to me because I thought objective and missions both are in a similar way.
Hmm.
That's the main issue.
Okay.
Now I understand.
Okay, good.
With your example.
Right. Okay. Other people, please. Others, please comment. Not on this slide alone, but the lot of things which we went through so far. Okay.
Can you please give me more insights on the interpersonal skills? I think that's very important. So,
okay. Let me go to that slide. You're talking about this one, right? Are you talking about this one?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, interpersonal skills is how we are able to relate to the other person. How are we talking to the person? How do we understand the person? And how I am able to interact with the person? Let me break down this into multiple things. First one is, how are we conversing with others? Communication. Okay. I may be talking all the time, not listening. So the moment we say interpersonal things, first thing comes is communication. How I communicate with the other person and how I receive the communication from the other person. First part. Second part is emotional intelligence. Understanding the other person's emotional status. Is that person angry, sad, happy, or is frustrated, annoyed? Then how do I behave? You can't go to a person who is annoyed already and then give him a nice dose of not doing the work and then come back. And that fellow is going to come back with a resignation letter. Because we need to understand the psychology of the person, understand what is the emotional status of the person. I'm not asking us to study psychology, do MA or something like that. At least by knowing the person, we know that if that fellow's face is not so happy, then something is wrong. So what is the best way to understand and then talk to that person? 5 minutes in a coffee, over a coffee, we can talk and then understand how we can help him out or do. So first thing is communication. Second thing is emotional intelligence. And third thing is balance of conversation. There are sometimes we go there, tell like AK-47, 10 lines and then come back. We don't even know whether the other person listened to me whether the other person understood me or not. So it is important to balance this communication between the other person and ourselves. Okay, so these are the basic things which go into interpersonal relationship. The next level, if you go, if I know that you like hockey, you play football, then I know which dish you like. Then when we sit and talk, we talk about those things which you know. And I also make sure that I am sharing my own hobbies and my own choices of, you know, food, etc. So then the relationship gets built stronger. And this is very important in the case of, let us say, clients whom we are dealing with the other nationals, right? Global clients, when we are dealing with them, it is important to know this. And the last part is, it is important to know what not to talk. Okay. Assuming that if there's an Indian coming in, if there is a client coming in and talking to an Indian about the China India standoff in the border, Ladakh, and he has a view that what China did is correct and he is coming and talking to us, it is actually going to kill my interpersonal relationship with him. Because me, I am an Indian, I know what India is doing is right, probably, right? But coming and talking to me about that is very sensitive topic. So identifying those sensitive topics, avoiding those sensitive topics in all our conversations is also interpersonal relationship intelligence. Okay, that is very important. So knowing the other person, knowing what to talk, knowing what not to talk. Okay, these are the basic tenets of our interpersonal communication. Did I answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So everything borders on, and the foundation is on communication and emotional intelligence. Okay. Okay, let me move on. And if you have still questions, you can ask me at the end. So we have formed the team. We have set them all ready to go. So now we have to start playing the game. So before you play the game, we define the ground rules. We define the ground rules. So defining the ground rules involves setting the clear expectations. Okay. What to do and what not to do. What is an acceptable behavior within the project teams? This is very, very important. Okay. There may be a woman in the, or there may be a girl in the team. We have to tell them that that girl cannot work beyond 8 o'clock. If she is working beyond 8 o'clock, somebody has to drop her at home. One of the members have to escort her home till she reaches home. This is one of the ground rules. We can't say that everybody is equal. We are all working till 10:30 in the night. You also stay till 10:30 and then just say bye-bye and go away. Though it is not directly part of the actual working, this plays a major role. It creates confidence. It creates trust among the people. Then this, we define the ground rules together as part of the team. All of us sit together and work out the ground rule, communicate the ground rule with all the team members. And we create an environment where everybody follows the rule, including the team member, including the team leader, including the functional people. Everybody has to follow the rules. Okay. We are, at least I believe in this. What you want others to do, I have to do. Okay. Then manage and rectify ground rule violations. Wherever there's a problem, if somebody has violated it, if you have to punish them, punish them. If you have to indicate to them, indicate to them. If somebody violates the ground rule quite often and frequently and periodically, that person has to be reprimanded. The person has to be punished or told that that is not acceptable. If you don't do it, today somebody makes a smaller mistake, tomorrow somebody will do a bigger mistake. And the person who does the bigger mistake will say, you did not do anything for that person, so don't do anything for me. So it creates a precedence. So it is very, very important that we follow the norms across everybody. So here, again, we talked about conflict management. To resolve conflict, we need to negotiate. To arrive at the ground rules, we need to do brainstorming, follow the ethics. All this is part of the defining the ground rules as part of enablers. We also define the team charter, what this team is supposed to achieve, what are all the values to be followed, what we agree to practice, and we all work together. It should contain all these things. If not everything, at least the major points are here. What is the shared value? You may not do it for every project because you follow the same values of the organization. Guidelines for the teams for communication and use of tools. We can't be using telephone, oral communication as a means of communication. We have to use some way of communicating, and that has to be grounded. Today, it has become a kind of default that people use public, the social media tools like WhatsApp or Signal or Telegram for their teams. And everybody is communicating on that. Should it be formalized by an email, or should it be only this way or that way? So that has to be decided when we are talking about the communication. How do we make decisions? Who makes the decisions? Is it collective? Is it the project manager alone? Or is it the technical architect? Who makes the decisions and how do we do it? Okay. How team resolves conflicts? This also is part of this. So we can define that we are going to have an open meeting and this is what we will discuss. And if in case we are not able to resolve it, we go to the next higher level. That is an agreement we are talking about. Okay. How do we meet? See, today, a lot of teams have this agile methodology. So they have the stand-up meetings, daily scrum meetings, every alternate day meetings, etc. So in Japan, I was there for about 8-9 months undergoing some training program. They used to have this 8 o'clock stand-up meeting. It used to be exactly for 10 minutes. All those, the agile models and other things evolved from somewhere, adopted from there. They stand up there for 10 minutes only to say what happened the previous day, what is the plan today, what are the showstoppers, what are all the achievements, appreciate or inform or warn people and then disperse. The meeting itself is exactly for 10 minutes. And people share what is to be done. And if you are talking about working from home, virtual teams, then there has to be a common time across the time zones. Okay, somebody sitting in West Coast, somebody sitting in Japan, somebody sitting in India, how do you align the timings? This all has to be agreed. Okay, this is very important. Then clear expectations, what can be done, what cannot be done, what is acceptable, what is not acceptable. Okay, all common ground to operate and help each other. Then why are we doing all these things? If we do all these things, we are creating a transparency. We are creating a performance expectation. Okay. Other thing is it creates less confusion. It actually avoids confusion. It improves performance. I know that I have to be here during this period. I know I have to do this. I have to deliver this. So it improves performance. In all, what it does is to show to everybody that there is a way of working and all of us follow this. We win together. That is the message we are going to give through this. Okay. We spoke about stand-up meetings. We also spoke about common working hours and we did not talk about this. This is very important. When you are talking about various files being created, various documents being reviewed, how will we number the versions? How will the document be named? How will you give the comments? How do you put the names of the reviewers in the comments? And where is the comment server? How is it getting stored? How the documents are retrieved and put back in place? Who will do that? Who is the person who will maintain the configuration? All of that becomes part of this. Okay. This is very important for a large project, a project which is going to run for 9 months, 12 months, etc. Okay. If you are running a project for 4 weeks, we don't need to do all this extensively. We must do it, but not so detailed. We'll tell them some certain points and it may be probably less than one page, A4 sheet, and that is pasted on the wall. So everybody follows that. But all this is required for a project which is of large size, cutting across multiple domains in the same organization, or cutting across multiple locations in the same organization. When I say multiple locations, part of the team may be in Hyderabad, part may be in Delhi, part may be somewhere else in the world. In which case, all this will become a must, without which it is bound to have problems and conflicts. Again, going further and emphasizing the same thing again, establishing the behaviors. We spoke about this so much. Okay, behaviors are very, very critical. Then how do they handle challenges as project progresses? Each project will have its problems. I'm sure all of us who have dealt with projects, we know it. How do we handle the challenges? Who does it? How do you escalate it to the next layer? What you solve and what you take to the next layer to solve? What you solve or what you bring in another person to solve? Some of these things have to be decided. Okay. Then we talk about communication approaches, shared values, decision making. All this we spoke, I put it here basically because I wanted to summarize the whole thing. Okay. Here again, there are some other behavioral aspects. I like this graph, so I put it here. We need to be punctual. Many a times people come for meetings 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes late by habit. I hate this actually. Persons who joined in time, they are actually wasting their time. Persons who joined in time are also busy. Persons who joined in time also have some other things to do. Still, they joined in time because respecting the requirement of, you know, common group norms. So as a practice, I started doing this when I was the business head in Wipro. I used to call for meetings at 10:35, 11:40, 12:15. I never used to call for meetings at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock or 10 o'clock or 10:30, because people take it for granted. The moment you say 10:35, and I also tell them this is the agenda, the meeting will get over in 90 minutes. The meeting will be over in 70 minutes. And I also do this in a meeting. Every meeting, I assign one person as a scribe. He will be the person to write the minutes of the meeting. Okay. That person will actually type the minutes of the meeting in his laptop. Except that person, nobody will have the laptop open. And everybody should come with a notebook in their hand. People have the feeling that I'll remember, I'll note down in my phone, I record it. I don't believe in all of them. Somebody has to come in and write it down. People, I don't think people can remember a lot of things. Okay, and with all the smartphones and phone books and other things, we just remember very little. Okay, so it is good to note down things. So thoroughness has to be there in whatever we do. And it also comes with responsibility. Okay, we have to be professional in the way we dress, the way we behave, the way we show our outlook, all of that. Ethical, we have to be ethical in our behavior. Ethical, we will see that in the next slide. We will talk about more on that. Okay, we have to be committed to the team, committed to the common goal, committed to ourselves, committed to our own progress as such. Motivated. In a project situation, there are going to be some high tides, there are some low tides. During the high tides, all of us will be happy, enthusiastic, and overdrawn. But when it is low, we shall still maintain our motivation. We shall still maintain our commitment to deliver. Okay, that motivation is a very, very important aspect. And whatever information we share has to be accurate. We can't simply say something because it is not our area. We can't simply say something and get away with it. These are all certain points which I consider as part of team norms. Okay. Unless otherwise we do this, the team will not become cohesive team. Then we talked about this in the previous slide. We need to behave with responsibility. How do you define responsibility? Responsibility is our duty, okay? To take ownership for all the decisions we have to make or we fail to make. Why is this given here? See, there are certain, as a project manager, we are supposed to take some decision to go with this architecture, to go with this design, or to go with this person, or to go with this or not to go with this. You taking the decision for going with this, it is fine, there's no problem. You also decide not to go with it sometimes. That has to be, the decision has to be taken and it has to be communicated. If you don't do it, then this will be lingering on. The people in the team will not know what to do and what not to do. In that process, time starts going off our track. 3 weeks into the future, we decide that it is not required. What happened? We have actually lost 3 weeks of time in our cycle. So responsibility is not only for taking a decision, responsibility for not taking actions. That also is part of our portfolio. We should respect people irrespective of the role. Okay, irrespective of the level. Okay. So respect is our duty to show high regard for ourselves, others, and the resources entrusted to us. This is also to people as well as non-people things. Respecting things what are given to us. Okay. It can be equipment, it can be money, it can be reputation, whatever it is. Okay. All of them come under this respect. Most of these things are very soft. I can talk about it, I can give examples, but again, one, unless otherwise we go through it, it becomes difficult. Fairness, being fair is very important. Okay. Being fair and being seen as being fair is also important. Okay. It's not only that we are fair, it should also be seen as being fair. Okay. So our conduct must exhibit that we are being fair in all our dealings. There is no interest of prejudice or favoritism for a particular gender or a particular caste or a particular region. We should be seen as a neutral person. My mother tongue is Tamil. In Wipro, when I was working there, a lot of people did not know what is my mother tongue for a long time. The moment one lady knew that I speak Tamil, she came to me. I was coming out of a meeting and she started talking to me in Tamil. I said, if you want to talk to me in Tamil, it has to be outside the office, not in the office. You can come home, I will come to your home, or we go to a restaurant, we sit and talk. We can talk in any language. Inside the office, inside a meeting, we are talking in English. The moment she was actually in tears. Suddenly, she broke into tears. You know, with the ladies, we have to be very careful. That was a lesson I learned that day. She said, no, I thought it's okay and all that. I said, see, it is fine. The moment somebody sees me talking to you in Tamil, then it can have different connotations. People will say that I am favoring you. Because you are a woman, people can say something else also. So I don't want to get into any of those things. That is the reason I said it was not to hurt you. I mean, it took some time for her to understand all this and then come to normal situation. But the moment I said this, tears burst into our eyes, actually. I could see that happen. So being fair is important. And then honesty. How do you define honesty? Dishonesty can be defined. Honesty cannot be defined. Who is a dishonest person? Who steals money? Who steals something else? Who doesn't keep up his words? All those things are there. But who is honest? The person who is not doing all those things. Okay. Honesty is our duty to understand the truth and act in a truthful manner. So this is what is our value system. You know, our Sanatana Dharma, whether you talk about Bible, Quran, Gurudwara, Granda, Sahib, or, you know, Bhagavad Gita, all of them talk about do your duty in such a manner that it doesn't hurt others. It doesn't come in the way of others. Okay. Whether it is in communication, acting, or doing. It has to be in that way. All our scriptures have said the same thing. Irrespective of the religion, value system of human behavior has been taught in a particular way, and we have to behave in that way. I mean, people will say that, you know, things have become corrupt and all that, but there are organizations which have been not involving in those activities and still doing the project in the best possible way. There are examples, published examples of E. Sridharan, published examples of companies like Wipro, Infosys, L&T, there are Tata's, they are all there for us to see. They have not compromised on the honesty to do their jobs. So we need to maintain this, and there will be questions on this in the exam, and there will be situations in our life which test us as human beings. We should pass both. With that, I want to open it out for question answer. And discussions, please. I want to thank you for listening to me very patiently, but I will be more happy if you ask questions, but not too difficult ones.
Yeah, I think this discussion is very important. All of you, the discussion could be sharing your experience, how you handled such situations. Or you can ask sir on any specific context, what kind of challenges he faced and then how did he maintain. Okay, so anything. But why I'm saying this is, this actually will be something, as he rightly said, you can expect in terms of scenarios in the DMP examination paper, as well as more importantly, you will face. Okay, it won't come with a pre-preparedness. You have to act extempo, and the words you speak, the decision you take, the action you implement will have a big stake. Okay, so I think
exactly. Thank you very much for strengthening that point, and you said it so nicely. Go ahead, friends.
Who is going to open it?
Yes.
Sir, I have one question. Yes. You said one example, like if a client, if he comes to the team member and ask about some conflicts. So at that time, how the project manager needs to intervene and avoid that point, because he is a client, we cannot able to cut that discussion by intervening that time. How in that situation, how we have to react, or how we have to tackle?
Good point. If I understand right, I will repeat the question in a different way. Just say whether it is understood properly or not, then I'll give the answer. What you are saying is, there is a client interaction with your team member, and the client is asking something which is going to result in conflict of interest. How do we handle this? Correct?
Yes, sir. Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Beautiful point. And it is very practical also. I will tell you generally what we have done in such cases. We have told our team members, these are all the framework within which you can operate. Anything beyond this is conflict of interest. We have told them very clearly. And we have also told them to escalate the matter to the next higher level. It could be the project manager, or it could be the next level of project manager, higher level of project manager. So what will the team member do? The team member will say, yes, I understand what you are saying, but that is coming in the conflict of interest purview. I won't be able to answer this. I will ask my seniors to get back to you. That is the way you deal with the client on the spot. We don't say, I will not answer you, this is not correct, or any such thing, and we leave it there. The next level, the project manager or the senior of the project manager can go and meet with them and understand this point a little more clearly, and then say the same thing much more politely with some examples. I can't share this with you. I'm sure you don't like your information being shared with somebody else. So we don't want to share this information because it is conflict of interest. So this is with respect to the technology and technical point. But if he is asking you to make a change in the project, okay, for which he says, I will not pay, or he is giving a change request, which is going to be included in the part of the project estimate, that is a different story. I am talking about technical information, which is creating conflict of interest. So we have to tell them upfront, we will not entertain this because it is conflict of interest. Like, I have signed an NDA with you, non-disclosure agreement with you. I have signed a non-disclosure agreement with the other party also. We can do this, and they appreciate it. They are also doing this as a test to see whether you are revealing something to them. The moment we reveal something to them, they will start suspecting us that we will reveal their information to somebody else. This is practical, actually.
Okay.
I will give an example. Now that you told this, one of our team members, it's almost 15, 18 years old, so I can tell the client name also. There's no problem. We were working with Nokia, and we were working on a very new project in the technology area. And then the person who was designing that particular application, he developed the code and put it in the developers forum, asking for suggestions. This is the use case. this is what I'm coding. I am not able to code within the footprint required. This is for mobile application. So there is a footprint required. That is a space requirement is very short. So I am not able to do it. Are there any suggestions for this? You put it in the developer forum. Unfortunately, in the developer forum, the Nokia manager who has given the project is also there. He looked at it. He called me immediately. I was two levels above the project manager himself. This was put by the developer. I was like a business head, but not a business head at that time. I was what was called as technical manager in charge of Nokia account. This is way back in 98-99. But I still remember it because it was a very difficult situation for us to handle. So the moment he called up and told me this, I said, sorry, I'll come back to you. Then I came back and analyzed the whole thing. Then we went back with a formal reply because I spoke to the legal people. They said, you have signed a non-disclosure agreement. This fellow has put it in the public domain. So which means you have disclosed this to the public domain. They can go to the court and claim damages. So let us give a formal reply. So we gave a formal reply saying that this was by mistake and still it is against the NDA, but we will never do this again. And we said we will change the architecture, we'll change the design and put it in a different way. And that fellow also agreed. Fortunately, he was a very good person on the other side. He agreed and then he said, okay, we will not do this. And from then on, every team member coming into the account, we had conducted a 1 hour session on being, confidential about various things. And we had kept a quiz also, and then making sure that they go through the quiz. And then we put some other means of putting it in the public domain. We stopped all those things. We put some measures to stop it. We also educated the members on the confidentiality part. It's a very difficult thing.
I think it's a very, very good case for discussion based on Arun's question. I tell you, in your examination, you can expect at least 2-3 questions on this very specific topic. I just derive few the key standard practices to be followed in such situation. He already mentioned, I'll just highlight it. Number one, there should be a boundary defined by the organization or by the project. Okay, what are the do's and what are the don'ts? And what is the process to be followed when it comes to these kind of situation? Second thing people should be informed about it well. So he said, after this incident, we derived a small tutorial and every team will be informed about it. So that is number two. Number three, we need to be transparent, okay, between the parties. There should not be any hiding. Okay, the mistake happened, it is inadvertent. So we need to accept and be transparent and acknowledge. So these things are something when it comes to conflict of interest. One more thing what I liked SARS doing is, sometimes we will follow these kind of careful in terms of conflict of interest items, but there is something called appearance of conflict of interest. Even that we should not be part of it. That is what he said. Okay, you may follow conflict of interest, but others also should know that you follow conflict of interest. You don't be part of it. So we have to demonstrate it in our actions, in our results, and in our the way we speak and appear in all those things. So this is very, very important topic. And thanks, Arun, for asking that question. Thank you, sir, for sharing these things. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
This is Suresh Babu.
Yes, Suresh. Yeah.
I have a couple of questions around the conflict of interest. So there are two scenarios, right? The very common scenario we see in the project is, either one team member coming and telling that, other team member is not doing their, finishing their user stories, on time, every iterations, they roll over the stories, their task, basically. That's one con, right? Team members coming and telling the other team members, I've been taking more overloaded, this team member is not doing, suppose, what they do, right? That one scenario. The another scenario is, we had a team member A and team member B, you know, they were in the project for a long time, and you know, our human tendency that you know even outside of work, you know, they're very good friends, you know, and then, you know, they had some personal conflict of interest outside of the work, but that brought into the work. Basically, the team member A is a developer and team member B is a QA. And then, you know, all of a sudden we started seeing the QA started putting a lot of defects against the particular developer, right? So how do you handle these kind of conflicts of interest? You know, this really happened in our team. I just want to get your views and thoughts. You know, how do you handle from your experience these two scenarios, conflict of interest?
Good, Suresh. Thanks for detailed explanation of the doubt. That helps a lot in terms of dealing with that. So there are two points, you raised two points. Let me answer one by one. The first one, there are two members, and within the team members, one is supposed to hand off something and the other one is supposed to take over from there. And that is not happening. In my view, there are two possibilities. There may be more, but at least this is what I've seen. One is the member who is not completing the work in time may not be doing it because of his capability issue, that he is not aware or she is not aware and she is unable to understand or she is unable to cope up with the load of work. It may be a genuine problem of inability to complete. More than capability, it is the inability to complete. That inability may be because of capability or maybe because of some other physical constraints. It may be a machine, it may be a license not being there, or it may be a document not available. It could be any one of them. The second possibility, second reason could be the attitude. I will hold it till the time the fellow comes and asks me. I will hold it till my project manager calls and tells me to finish it because I want to be seen as important for this project. If it is the first one, we need to find out. As a project manager, we need to have the patience to do two things. One is read what is visible and understand what is invisible. Okay. So how do we read what is visible? By observing what is going on. But understanding what is invisible, we need to go around, talk to people, have conversations over the coffee table, etc., and then get to know this. So if it is a capability issue, we need to address it by providing training program, providing support, giving additional hand or giving training, whatever. That has to be done as part of the inability part, capability part. If it is an attitude issue, then we need to have a hard talk with that person. Why is it happening like this? And it's a schedule understood, schedule, you know, agreed upon by everybody. And you are in the train where you pass on this to the next person. You can't be the roadblock or a speed hump, speed breaker. This has to be communicated in a meeting, one-on-one probably. If it doesn't improve, it has to be followed up with a mail between the project manager and the member. If it still doesn't improve, we have to bring the HR into picture and then have a tri-party meeting, and it goes in a very escalated fashion. The idea is to find out those attitudinal aberrations and then bring them to books. That is one way we have dealt with. And whatever I told you, exactly the same way I have dealt with many cases over a period of time at different levels of seniority. It's not only project managers I am talking about. Manager or project manager also behaving this way, like you described, Suresh. That is the first part. The second part is two members are pally all the time, and then suddenly they develop some chemistry mismatch. And then one is finding fault with the other because of the role they are playing. This is a clear case, you know, because you know that they are there and because this has developed over a period of time, you know, you are able to spot it, which means you have been observing and you have been a good leader. You have been able to observe the aberrations in the behavior, and the cause for it also is predicted by you in some sense. So the next step is to go deeper. Either have a one-on-one with both of them separately and then patch it up, or have a meeting together with both of them. Personal is personal, official is official. The personal things cannot be brought into official. And we have to clearly tell them that project is paramount importance, not you or me. So we have to finish the project. And if it doesn't improve, we have to actually take them to task by, you know, going through the same thing, you know, from talk to mail, mail to HR, that has to be done. The other way, which is not a very good way, is change one of them to go to another role and bring another person here. In case you don't have time to do all this, there are not, I mean, in our projects, we don't have the time, luxury of time, all the scenarios. If you are running very tight ship and then milestones are there, deliverables are there, and this is coming in the way, you don't have time to spend with them, go through the steps of escalation. Simply remove this person and bring another person from the project, change the roles of people as a part of a job rotation and see whether it improves. I mean, that is a drastic step. It may not yield the best result in all situations, but in the absence of time and our ability to deal with it at that point in time, this would be the next best option.
For the second question, make a small correction.
We
need to do that first one first and then second one second as a priority, because first thing is the one-on-one informal correction, understanding, and then making it clear to them, and then maybe bring them together. Once you bring them to the same page, then it can be discussed, and then very conducively we can conclude. If that doesn't work out, if that attitudinal problem is hurting the other person as well as the project, I think then the question of changing action should be taken. In fact, this will be again one of the FEMP examination question: in what sequence you will implement these actions. So that's the point. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you so much for answering that. Yeah, because this always happens. You know, one team member always feels that, you know, I'm taking more overload because some other person is not doing right. So we go through and then see by iteration, you know, how many story point is being committed at the beginning, and whether this person is capable of delivering consistency, or is that behavior is, you know, same. He may be missing last four iterations, the same thing, right? Not completing all the user stories. Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right.
Yeah. And in the second scenario, yeah, same thing happened. You know, I was being the scrum master for the team. And that is a behavior we noticed. You know, we do the stand up every day. Even the team member A and B, they are not even, you know, looking at each other while doing the scrum. You know, can you think of, you know, sitting in a room, because we used to sit in everybody in one room, and you know, and they are being reporting to different development managers. So we tried best way. I brought it up to the development managers, but unfortunately, we tried. You know, it didn't work out. We ended up changing the team member.
That is the only way out.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's yeah.
The other part, slightly off track, I don't know whether it will work or not. It depends on the organizational culture. When you talked about completing the stories and then dragging them, there is a Kanban system, the Japanese way of putting the bar charts, names, and what is their target, what they completed. Each one, as and when they complete, they go and mark green on the portion what they are supposed to complete. If they completed within the time, they get green. And if it is not done, it becomes orange. And if it becomes too long, then it becomes red. So it is there for everybody to see. There's a peer pressure that I don't want to become red. This we tried in only one project. It worked in that project, but we didn't make it across all projects because there was a lot of resistance. It requires a little more of maturity. But in case it becomes too much for you to deal with it every day in and day out, you can try this.
Yeah, but I think in the new way of agile, these things are being discouraged. What is encouraged is team members should support each other, and it will be more of high performing and a cohesive team.
Correct.
Okay, together they need to achieve.
Yes.
And the role of the scrum master or project manager is to kind of help them to overcome those impediments. And the team should be kind of empowered, measuring collectively what they can do and assume the work and deliver it. So the individualistic green, yellow
amber, red and all these days.
It may not be very good. That's why I said it depends on the culture of the organization, the way we are doing it. Today, scenario is what I'm talking about is 10 years back.
Correct. Yeah.
So times have changed. So correct. We need to adapt it to the requirement. Thanks for that. Yes.
Yep. Thank you so much.
Right. Yeah. Anybody else have any questions? In fact, many of you would have listened to these things, not this much detail. Okay. We just take about 3 to 6 hours to handle all the 14 topics. So we thought there should be another extended session as part of your post workshop. So this should help you to internalize and then ask questions, quote examples. So that's, I think, that's one of the four primary objective of this session. Anyone else have any questions? We have Bhargav, Shanta Kumar, Jayanti, Nishita. Or even if you have some good live experiences you can share, that will be more meaningful to others as well.
Yes, I agree with him. I agree with Srinivasan, sir.
I think going forward, since we announced these topics well in advance, I want all of you to come prepared, challenge the faculty, challenge each other. Okay, so that's how we should take this series forward.
I love difficult questions.
Yeah. And sometimes, no, sir, we need to be ready for the reverse mentoring. See, your experience and my experiences are 30-year-old, 20-year-old, 15-year-old. Okay, so today's marketplace pressures and expectations are quite different. And
Correct.
Yeah, so.
Agree with you.
Sir, meanwhile, I have shared the webinar feedback in the chat. So I request all of you to submit your feedback about the webinar in the link.
Yeah, that process also is important.
Yeah, I think since this is being the first session, please be open to express your feedback, and definitely we will take them into account and redefine, redesign, improve. Sir talked about continuous improvement already, creativity already. So we are open for that, all those things.
Yeah, and to add to what Srinivasan sir said just now, the whole idea is to make it more lively, interactive, and useful for the dual purpose. The dual purposes are to go through the exam and to be able to apply them in the live situations in the organization. So we are open, and we, both of us, have that much of experience. We should be able to relate to anything what you ask. So we should be able to give you all the potential answers and potential scenarios. Okay. And if you want something else to be done, please say that. We will modify it as required. Okay. If you want it to be covered in a different way, we will do it. Please be open. This is meant for you, not for us. So exactly. We are ready.
And also, we are willing to correct ourselves wherever if something is incorrect, we are open.
Yes.
Yeah. Good, anyone? So it's 7:53. We have 7 more minutes. And please fill up your feedback forms. And then also, I would like to hear any of you some open feedback. Okay, may not be subject related question, but how do you want this to go on in the future? So even if you are what is going good, we should continue. What is something where we need to bring in new alignments? Okay, you can share with us. Hope in the next session there will be more good interactions and heated debates. It's, but definitely this was quite useful. I learned a lot, and I believe you also learned much. So on behalf of Provi team, I want to place my thanks to BKM sir for his a lot of preparations has gone behind reading the ECO document, reading the PMI's PMP prep guide, the slide deck and other things. So he has put his experience and other reference items into it. So thank you, BKM, and then we'll continue this effort in the rest of the sessions of this series. Thank you for your participations, all of you. I hope this was useful, and we hope to see you in the coming sessions as well. And we'll keep you informed about it well in advance so that you can block your calendars. And so thank you very much. And if you have any questions, you can place it. Otherwise, if you are completed your feedback, you can actually sign out.
Okay. Good. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I enjoyed preparing for this, and I enjoyed delivering it as well. So hoping to meet you with some more people. If you want to bring them in, they are always welcome. And then be more interactive in the coming sessions. I wish you all the very best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Bye bye.
Good night, all of you.
Good night.